Okay, so let's start, and if people will be joining later, they will arrive just in time after the boring part, hopefully. So welcome to the fourth edition of the Low Code Café. That is the name that we give into this weekly webinar. That is a community-driven event, or maybe more to say community-focused event, because in this weekly webinar we focused on discussing more technical topics, more about the product roadmap, the features that we are developing, and we even invite guest speakers to present what they built with Plant an App, their challenges, how they solved them. So it's a great space to get involved, to discuss, and I encourage all of you, if you have something to say, to ask, to discuss. There are a few different channels you can do this. You can use the chat window, the Q&A window, and of course you can also raise the hand, and I will make you a panelist, so you can do voice as well. This is the fourth edition, as I mentioned. There are three other editions, and they are all published on our YouTube channel. So let me grab this link and post it to you in the chat window. So make sure to visit it to review what we built so far, and also there are other videos besides webinars. So there are some training videos, some more advanced training videos we started doing recently, like caching issue. Dale Werner has just produced that. It's not published yet, but it will be. So there's a lot of stuff coming, so make sure to subscribe to our channel and see the videos as they come out. For today, I was thinking to do more like a community update, to touch on various points that we are doing, that maybe there are some leftovers from the last webinar when we built an app from scratch, and I want to touch on that as well. But this is not a fixed agenda, so if you have anything that you want to discuss, make sure to bring it up, and we'll adjust the discussion so everybody makes the most out of this time we spend together. So I will start with a brief community update, and I will let other people in my team go into details on some of this. So first, I want to announce that we started work on a new community portal. So this will be a space. First of all, it will be a forum kind of solution, probably closer to Stack Overflow kind of doing things. So that will be a space where anybody can come in, ask questions, and help others with their challenges. But also we'll add other bits and pieces there, like voting for features or seeing the roadmap. So stuff like this, where the community can get involved to participate in driving this product. Because what makes Plant an App great, and what even the DNN Sharp, which was the company from which Plant an App spinned out of. What makes this technology great is when people get involved and they give voice to what they need, to what they want to accomplish, because that makes a product great, being able to use it for achieving one's objectives. So we encourage that on all channels to engage with us. And this community portal will be like the main gateway into that. So in terms of roadmap, it will probably, the first release will probably be out in maybe 2 weeks. And then we'll keep iterating, adding more features. So we are first focusing on the question and answer, or the Stack Overflow part. We also have expanded our team. Dale Werner, which you already know, because he had a webinar around 1 month ago. If you remember, we played some very interesting games with with the technology, with the systems that he built on Plant and App. So that was a very different use case for low code, for this kind of low code systems to build online games. It was a fun webinar. I encourage you to also see that. And we also have 4 more developers in our team. So this means that starting maybe next month, we'll have a faster delivery cycle. So we'll increase the features that we release, and that's a good thing for us and for all our customers. I also have something that I will bring up with you today. We have a new pricing model that we are thinking of. So I would like, if I can get your feedback and your opinions and your arguments, why it's good, why it's not good, I will present that to you briefly, and it will help us a lot. And then I will give control to Reza to show you a bit about where we are at with the current release, what's coming in the next releases. So Reza Garrow, he's leading our product development team, and he has a very good grasp of everything that's going on in the product. Okay, so maybe before going into all that, I would like to touch a bit on the last week webinar on the application that we built. So in case you weren't there, there's a video published. The recording is published on the Plant and App, so you can see it. But it was basically, so let me go back to it. It was basically a task management application. It was a simple task management that we did in 1 hour. We encounter a lot of problems that we had to address. So that was like a very real developer experience. That's what would happen when you start developing. So I think that was very good to also to me, because I don't usually build apps. So we have teams that do that. So for me, it was also an experience, but I had help from the guys in my team. Whenever I got stuck, they would help me unblock. So just to go over the app last week briefly, what it did, and show you how we fixed the remaining issues. So basically, we had a simple task management app. We created one entity for the task. It had some properties. It was linked to a customer, so we could have multiple customers. Each customer would have task for them. And then we would track time for each task. So we created another entity that is kept for time tracking. And then here, what we did, we just track the start time, and then we calculated the hours dynamically when you would hit a stop button. So going back to the main screen of the application, how it worked was like this. So I go under task, I can create new tasks for customers, and then I can see how many hours I spent on this task, and then click the start button, which updates the status, I'm working on it. And then when I click the stop button, it stops time tracking and adds 1 hour because we round it up, so to be able to test it. Now, last week, this didn't work because a mistake that I did. And the mistake was that I was calculating rounding down to minutes, and we are clicking that fast that it never got 1 minute to round it up to 1 hour. So in case you watch the last week webinar, I will show you the change that I did to make that work. So it was in this calculate time action. And here it was calculating based on minute and dividing by 60. And now I converted it to seconds and dividing by 3,600 seconds. So then I can get accuracy up to the second. So that's how we fixed this. We had more ideas on this application. The next part that we are going to do was billing. So then in the customers listing, maybe have an ability to bill these hours. But we never got to that. In 1 hour, I think we made a lot of progress. We'll probably continue this, especially if there is interest like building more stuff or demoing some features that are relating in to this. So we'll see how this webinar evolves, but this could be like a recurring stuff where we keep adding things to demonstrate like new features or new techniques to achieve a feature. Last week also I didn't have prepared the connection to the database to see what is generated behind the scenes, because right now you can see in entities that there are some entities, some are built-in like user role document, some are custom like from customer downwards. So these generate real database tables, and when they are linked they also generate relationship tables between them. So now I prepared also connection to the database so I can show you what was generated behind the scenes. You can see here in the database, all my application tables are created in a separate schema. This schema is called app. And you can see that it has five tables now. It has the customer table, and as you would expect, they have the columns that we defined in the entity builder, right? If we look at task, it has the columns that we defined there. And you see there's a customer property in the task, and you see that it has a foreign key. So in other words, these two tables are linked through a foreign key. So that's the beautiful part about using the entity builder. Everything gets glued, wired together. Following best practices. So you'd have index keys, you'd have foreign keys on these tables, and that will be achieved out of the box. Of course, there might be some situations when you need to optimize for something and you'll add your own index keys, but out of the box, the code is optimal and follows best practices. One thing where we were stuck last week also, was getting the total amount of hours. So let me go back to the application a bit. Was to get the total amount of hours per task. So this number here. And if you remember, we added a computed column that used a token. So I will jump directly to showing you how we created this token. So under the task namespace, we have a get total hours token. And basically what we did last week, it was just the first line. We summed the time tracking for all the tasks because I didn't have this relationship table nearby. So now I did the inner join with the task time tracking table. So this links the task to the time tracking. And then of course, filter based on a task ID parameter that get passed into this token. Okay. So now the usage, let's look at the listing. Listing had this computed field, total hours, which invokes that token. So notice the syntax, the token syntax, and passing the task ID parameter. And it passes the ID, which is the ID of the current row, so the current task you're clicking. So that's how we were able to fix the other issue as well. So now we have a simple but working application and usable. So I will not dwell a lot on this unless there are questions. And I see there is a question from Ben. Not so much a question as maybe a suggestion. I noticed all entities had default fixed built-in properties. If these properties are always there, would it be easier to have them shown at the bottom of the page instead of the top? That way user can just start on the top of the page and add their own property fields. I think you are very, very right with what you propose. And in fact, and I think Reza will work will present more on this. In fact, for a future release, we'll change this entire screen. So let's look a bit at the task. So instead of having a single list of properties, you'll have groups, right? So then you'll have a main group that goes on the grid and in the main form. And then you can have multiple optional groups. And these properties you can drag in the main group, or they can stay on secondary groups. And you can create new groups as well, right? And these groups will be very useful, especially when you end up with having a lots of fields in an entity. But also we'll use them later to drive how you input data. For example, in the main form, you don't want to add 100 fields that will make it unusable for any user that is still sane out there. Instead, we'll just show the main group, and then on the detail page, you can touch and edit the rest of the groups. So yes, you are right. And then the main group will be at the top. Yeah, another question from Roberto. In the new MyTokens interface, is it still possible to create Razor scripts? Of course, that's one of the powerful features here. So it's again, we used to have a pop-up with tabs here. It was difficult to manage. So now it's more like it flows on the page. So you create a token, and then under definition, you still have all the types. Except few, we retreated. We had some email tokens that you could extract from emails. We had some FTP tokens. We retreated that as they are replaced by other features in the product. So yeah, you can still create a Razor token here. Select the code language. So all the features that were there are still here. And additionally, we have syntax highlighting here. So that's good. We also, this window appears small, but as you grow your script, it will get bigger. So then you have more space to put scripts. Some of these scripts will get complicated, so you have more space to write them. Okay. So I don't see any more questions. So if there are no more questions, we can move forward. And of course, at any point, we can drive, we can change the discussion. And if there's time at the end, we can do even more questions. And of course, we don't have a hard limit most of the time. So then if we need to go a few minutes over, we can do that as well. Okay. So that's what I wanted to touch on the last week webinar, because I felt that I left things not finished, and I can't stand that. I have to finish things to be working, to be in a good state. And I hope I achieved this now. So now I can move on to discuss the pricing, the new pricing model a bit. We had many discussions with various members from our existing community, but new customers as well. We had feedback regarding the current pricing that we have, which is per end user of the application. That I understand that is difficult for many use cases. It's in fact the industry standard in the local space, but I agree that maybe it's not for us. So then we discussed it and put in place a new pricing model that basically tries to handle more categories of customers. There are those customers that are more like developer companies, developers. They do a lot of systems. So then we created a per developer seat model. And then there are those end customers that they build internally, right? So for them, we made a per app model. And of course, in between, there are those partners that resell software. So we do have also a partner commission model. And for people familiar, we offer that as an alternative to Evolve. So let me go a bit to the pricing, and if you want to comment, make sure to raise your hand or type. I would love to hear your feedback, because this is not yet launched, so we are still working on it, making sure it's the right thing. Okay, so then we have two pricing models. Let's discuss the per developer seat. In this pricing model, I also try to make it obvious when you choose one over the other. So with the per developer pricing, it assumes that the partner, the developer partner, it's handling the customers directly. The customers would not own their license. The partner will own it for them. And the partner will not come directly to support from Plant & App. They will always go to the partner, and the partner will come to us when they need to escalate. And of course, this model doesn't generate any commercial commissions. So then we also created various plans here, and this is in line with what we've seen people doing on our platform, right? We have the citizen developer plan, which is first, and the citizen developer is more like a no-code user. So they use systems like maybe Babel.io, right? Where they use a lot of drag and drop. They don't get to write code only in exceptional situations, right? So then we model our offering for these users at a lower price, and then they have all the features that we offer, so access to all the modules that we inherited from the previous business, but as well as new features. But they don't have the coding action, so they can't write SQL, they can't write C Sharp or Reza, and they cannot write JavaScript. And we also have other actions like PowerShell, command line scripts. So they don't have access to that. That comes to the next tier, right? We call it the low-code engineers. And this is somehow a term that's popping up more and more, right? Because initially low-code was more like, was initially more for, let's build something quickly, you know, that is not overly complex. But then, you know what happens when people start using it, they want more and more. So then a citizen developer in many cases is not the person to do the application from start to finish anymore. They need more technical people along the way to deliver those. And these more technical people, it's usually real developer, a traditional developer, let's call it a traditional developer that knows the programming language and can get into to implement the custom logic. So, that is the low-code engineer plan. Also, one other separation here is that we are thinking of splitting the connectors that we currently have and that we are going to build into the standard connectors, which are more like MailChimp, PayPal, Stripe, that kind of category. And then the premium connectors, which are more moving more to bigger application, to enterprise application like Salesforce, Dynamics CRM, that kind of connectors. And I have them detailed on another page in this document. And then another differentiator here is the premium support. So right now, we do have our help center. We haven't done so much SLA support so far. So the standard support doesn't have any SLA. What we had so far for SLA was more premium support incidents. So we want to encourage people to use that more. And that's why we also include it in this plan, because I think you can help people on the help desk ticket for simple stuff, but as it gets into a complex requirement, it's very difficult to do that in typing on a help desk system. So then maybe a premium incident is more suited, as it can, it allows us to put someone on the case, connect remotely with the customer or with the partner and address the issue. And then we have two more tiers. I would not go into this. I don't feel like this is well defined now, extension developer. And also, of course, an enterprise developer where we add more enterprise level features like audit, single sign-on providers, dedicated success manager, and stuff like this. So this is the per developer pricing. And then is the per app pricing. So it's also not exclusive. I mean, you don't have to have only per developer or only per app license, especially as a partner. What will happen, maybe you have per developer license that you use for most of your customers, but you'll get that one customer that they want to own the license. They want to get direct support from Plant & App. They want a managed infrastructure in our cloud instead of owning it their own. So then here we, and also this generates partner commissions for the partner doing the sale. So then we have here also four different plans. I'm not sure about this one. We are thinking about creating like a lower cost plan that maybe we don't give so much support because it's a no code app. So it will not be ability to do custom SQL and things like that. And then also like if it's in our cloud, store it as a single environment. So then it keeps the cost low for us. So this one we are still thinking about. The next one, I think we are pretty much decided, and this is what we've actually been able to sell in the past few months. So this will be the equivalent of the low-code developer plan in terms of capabilities, right? So again, you have the low-code features, you have the premium connectors, you know, but then we also include a number of premium support incidents and three environments, of course, if it's in our cloud, and dedicated VM if it's in our cloud again. And then we are thinking of creating a bigger plan that is for larger solutions, like it's a AWS auto-scaling infrastructure that we put in place for such customers so it can handle bigger loads. And of course, I mean, between these two prices, there's a lot of margin for discussion. I mean, you don't need maybe to have this auto-scaling cloud, or you don't need to have it 1,000. That's where we position it, like 1,000 concurrent users. So then maybe you need something in between, or the end customer needs something in between. Or of course, we are open to discuss. And in fact, for the enterprise plan, we'll not have public pricing, but request the code, because there are so many things to discuss what go into the pricing. On the feature side is one, but then also on the amount of support and the account management features, the single sign-on providers, which is a big thing in enterprise. And with every single sign-on configuration, there is some time that we have to put into that, of course. And then, of course, for selling this kind of apps, the partner would have commissions. So for the first app for a customer, so for the first app one of your customers buys, we are thinking a 25% commission, which is paid for the first year. And these prices are all per year. I don't think we'll go per month, because maybe just for a trial period, but I don't see a world where you want to pay per month for a system, because a system lives a lot more than 1 month. So then for the first app, it will be 25%. And then for their second app, so for a customer second app, a second license, there will be a 50% discount. And also for upgrading tier, right? So if a customer goes from this plan, let's say from Harvest to Grow, there will be an additional 15% discount commission, sorry, 15% commission to be paid out of the difference, of course. And then in the following years, a 5% renewal commission. Okay, so this is the pricing model. There are more pages in here, like detailing other support options that we have, training packages, premium support packages, so you can buy more incidents than what we include in plans. Security audits, we do quite a few of those to look at implementations to see that they do not expose vulnerabilities. We do source code scroll, because PlantanApp, we don't sell it with the source code, but still you can get we can put it on a third-party scroll service where you have access to in case something happens with PlantanApp. And then, of course, success management options, which this is something that we do more and more, especially for our enterprise level customers. And of course, detailing various level of support, SLA, there's the connectors piece that I was telling you about, the standard connectors and the premium connectors, and other details about the terms. I will not go into this. I'm just interested to hear like your opinion about what I presented so far, and I'd be happy to send this document on email if you want to take like a closer look at it. So let me know if you have any feedback questions. I hope that's not a bad thing, nobody's saying anything. Yeah, so I see some familiar names in this meeting, I know that probably this is the third pricing that we are working on to publish. I received this feedback from David, who is in the call, that you changed your pricing, three times until now. And if it was the right pricing, of course, we wouldn't change it. But our idea is that we want it to be a win-win situation. And the previous pricing, we didn't get that it's a win for our customers, for our partners. I mean, they told us that they cannot scale without pricing, and that's why we came up with this new model. Okay, if you don't have any feedback, I think there will also be at the end of the webinar, when you exit the webinar, there will be a feedback form, so it will be great if you can, it's not a big form, it's a simple form, so if you can fill that form and you can add more thoughts there, or just send the feedback on email, that's also very much appreciated. I see a question. So the per developer pricing is for non-hosted customers. Yes, of course, we cannot give, maybe I didn't point this out correctly, but the per developer seat allows unlimited usage. So any number of instances for on-premise instances, right? So it allows you to use Plantan app to build 100 apps if you want, but it's all on-premise, of course. We cannot give that kind of unlimited service for cloud hosted applications. And then we have another question from Jim. I was late to get here. Can you talk through how an independent developer with small business? I'm not sure I understand the question. It's like he's missing something. You can also raise hand if you want or update your answer. Or I will answer to the best of my capability to understand. So basically this is per developer seat, so which means that we have a lot of those smaller customers that maybe they have one developer, some are one-man teams that build systems. So they will only pay one developer seat, right? Which will be one of these two. And most likely, as the application get more complex, it will be this plan, the low-code engineer plan. But then as you have more developers, each will have to own their own license, and you can combine them. I mean, if you have like one person that, it will never write code, he will be on this plan, on the citizen developer plan. He can go in, add email actions, add PDF actions, call some APIs, use the built-in actions. But then if he needs help from somebody writing code, that the other person will have to be on this license to use the low code actions, we call them. So I think this price is fair because then it's a win-win. The more a partner, the more developers, they have working on apps. That means the more apps they deliver, the bigger the value for them, which is the bigger value for us as well, because we get additional developer licenses. So another question from Ben. So per developer seat license structure, citizen developer has no access to custom coding, SQL, Razor, etc. To get access to those features, you need me at the low-code engineer level. Yes, but I also discussing like people that are used to DNS Shark way of doing things. You know that without SQL, you cannot do a lot of stuff. But in Plant and App, even without SQL, you have those actions that generate for every entity. So then if you have like a customer entity, you'd have actions to create new customers, update customers, right? So they are already actions. And I think we can let's look at the form. I hope I'm not logged out by now. So you have those actions that eliminate the need to write SQL, especially for the simple stuff, right? Like the crude stuff. Of course, as your application gets more complex, you'd have to write code, and that's the power of all of this, of the low code, right? When you need something custom, you can do it. You are not limited by the technology. So this is the task page. So then in the form, if you look at the actions, you see there is an action called create new task, right? So here you just give it value. In this case, these are form values. And this does the insert into table behind the scenes. So you don't need the SQL action as much for the simple stuff as you'll need it for more complex application down the road. So I'm hoping this answered the question, Ben. Okay, so we still have 20 minutes left, so let's move on to other topics here. And again, as I was telling you, I'd be happy to hear your feedback on any channel. That's good. So moving forward, I want to pass word to Reza Garrow. He leads our product development team, to show you a bit about the current release and what's coming in 1.7, 1.8 and further. So Reza, if you are there, I will make you a panelist. Okay, cool. So you are on mute.
Can you enable video, Bogdan?
Sorry?
It says video is disabled.
Okay. Allow panelists to start video. Yeah, you should be able to start it now.
There we go. Okay. Everyone, are you still sharing your screen?
I can stop it. You can take over.
Actually, just the slide you were on was fine. Okay. So yeah, I want to make sure we get some time to kind of take round two of that application. But and so I'll go through this kind of quickly. But I just want to call out, you know, one DNN 9.6 support comes out for us today in release 1.6. It's a very big release. Tons of stuff in there, not just DNN 9.6. And we touched on it, you know, in prior weeks. A couple of the key highlights being the new MyTokens UI and also 10 items from a support center. So not just Plant and App focus, but the DNN Sharp modules, Action Form, Action Grid, some of the add-ons all have had been touched and enhanced or fixed up in little ways. And so it's a really good one. One breaking change I did want to call out in all the things that we've done here is that if you have a execute API action, not the server request where you're typing in the key values, but where you've used the dropdowns to map and you're calling an API endpoint. Those we've unified in the UI, so you don't have to pick as many things, but it will lose what the method that you were calling was. You just pick it from the dropdown again and all your settings and everything are preserved. So it's very recoverable, but you'll see that you might get an error when you're trying to execute an existing action that already was wired up to endpoint. 1.7 is the, so that's releasing today, and that'll come out in the newsletter a little bit later. 1.7 is the, what we're working on now. That one's set to release next week at this time. We're doing a lot of design and planning for 1.8 and beyond, but not the types to be able to sit on our hands. And so we decided in this one, other than the hosted Plantin app coming defaulting with 9.6.1, really just went ahead and took it as a minor release, but again, put a lot of focus on different requests and bugs and things that were out in the support center. And just, again, kind of a customer reward release. And so just in these last two releases, there's a lot of little improvements and fixes. Some of the things are newer, some have been around for a long time and have been tackled finally. So be on the lookout for that next week. And then looking at 1.8, 1.9, and kind of building us up to Plantin app 2.0, this will be what's going on over the next 30, 60, 90 days. We're gonna release this incrementally, but a big focus on entity management. And you know, when we say entities, we don't just mean defining your tables and your fields, but all of the UI and UX that gets generated automatically by the system when you do define your data structure. And so the pages that are created, the forms, the grids, Bogdan touched on earlier, having a lot of control and being able to define and group and together your fields. And then decide where they show up on the screen, when they show up, this sort of thing, what do they show up in. Page management, being able to really control better where and when pages show up in the menu, when they're hidden, when they're just used to nest child items. A whole new Angular grid coming out, so not the action grid, very similar, but rewritten front-end-wise from the ground up to leverage a lot of the modern technologies that are out there in Angular, making it easier than ever to upgrade. So in release 1.5, we introduced the ability to install all dependencies with one push, right? So here's action form, action grid, all these things have updates to them. You don't need to download those and upload them. You just push a button, they're installed automatically for you. We're gonna take that one step further. And when a new release of Plantin app comes out, you'll be able to choose to install that and all dependencies. So truly a one-click upgrade, bring you to current. We have the KPI dashboard we've been working on for a while. It's going out as a proof of concept in this release, where it can be added as a module and tried out. So it's very much a kind of alpha beta thing, but we're taking that to MVP in 1.8 and beyond. And so you'll have new line charts, being able to leverage SQL data sources, other things. So a lot of good stuff coming, really focusing in on our UI and user experience that's generated as in the application that you're building and developing to your customers, and having more control over that and just being able to have it themed and skinned and look a lot better. So that's it. I want to keep it short and sweet and make sure we have some time to build.
Cool. Thanks, Reza.
Thank you.
Yep, so a lot of cool things are coming. There is a follow-up on the licensing from Jim. As a developer, I would have a license to build a complex app running my own hosted environment. And then for a customer that wants to have their own instance, we could port the app to the Plantin app environment, the customer would then get their own license. Yeah, so basically it's you don't have to do it. I mean, you can host the customer and they don't need a new license. You can host them with your license, right? So the developer license gives you ability to do all your customers. But yes, if you either want to host them on our cloud or they need support from us, they need maybe SLA from us, and they need some customers, they really need to own their license, they need a license agreement, then yes, they would move to this model. But this model again works both on-premise and on our cloud. So then if you want to keep continue hosting them or host them internally in their infrastructure, that's also possible. They don't have to be in our cloud, but the pricing is the same, right? Cool. Yeah, so we touched a lot of stuff today. We still have 15 minutes left. So is there anything particular that anybody wants to discuss further? If not, we can use the time that we have to that is left to take our project management application further, maybe add the invoicing part or at least start it. Okay. Let's get dirty. So here in the project management application that we have, we also had a customer page that we created last week. And this customer page also had an hourly rate per customer, so we can bill customer differently. So then our vision was that, yeah, let's add a button here that will send them the invoice, the PDF invoice via email with the billable hours. So then really what we have to do here is create a new button and then create a workflow that generates the PDF invoice. Right? So let's start with the workflow. So I create a new workflow and then let's think about it. What would be the first step would be to get the total number of hours per customer. We already have the hours, they are logged. Probably this today will not have time to also mark which hours were billed and which not. So we'll bill all the hours every time you click the button. So let's see. I mean, the easiest thing, I can start with the PDF, right? To generate the PDF. And I remember last week I had some HTML template, but it's on a different PC. So we'll just mock some PDF template for now. So generating PDF is very simple. It just does HTML to PDF. So maybe we just pull some fields, bill to, and then we put the customer name, right? And we don't have this token yet, but I'll show you in a minute how we do it. Maybe the bill date. Yeah, we just use date time now. And then maybe we need an invoice number. And actually this could be its own entities, you know, invoices. But right now, I think we can just do something like grid new, I think. Somebody from my team, please correct me when I'm wrong. Okay, so let's do this at the minimum for a PDF. Notice that I haven't put the hours yet. So then I have this PDF and I can save some information about it. So for example, I can store its absolute URL. PDF URL. So I create a new variable that will store the URL. And for now, what I will do is I will return this as an output. Maybe, I mean, internally PDF URL, it's a good name, but outside of this workflow, PDF URL doesn't mean anything. So maybe we call it PDF invoice URL, right? And then as input, we have to give it to the customer. So remember, we use the customer token. So here I can say that customer, it's a type of type customer. It's an entity type. So now those token that you saw here, the customer name would work because customer is an input parameter now. So let's save this workflow, call it generate PDF invoice. And we can test it right here to make sure it works. So let me check. I think both tasks are under the same customer, so under Acme Inc. And Acme Inc. has ID1. So here I can test with ID1. It will output the PDF invoice URL as I instructed. I can go to this to look how my to check how my invoice looks like. So you can see the customer name is in here, the bill date, the billing date, and the invoice number. It's all everything in here, right? So I have the basics. Now what I need is the number of hours, and to multiply that with the fee that I associated with that customer, right? So then to get the total number of customers of hours, I have a few options. The easiest for me at least would be to do a query that returns the total. So going back here, we did here some select time tracking. So I already summed them, but for a single task. What I want to do now is maybe sum them, but for a given customer. Right. So then I can inner join this with a with the customer. So I need to get to the customer. So I need to inner join with the task table, because here I have a customer ID reference. So then I inner join with this app dot task. Let's call this TT, time tracking. Time tracking, so this is task on t dot id equals, and we have the task id in this table, task timing. This is the relationship table, which I have it down here, so we know we have a task id column here. T dot task id. Good. So now when I run it, I have an invalid column somewhere. Invalid column task ID. So TT, oh, it's from T join, sorry. Okay. So now I have 7 hours in total. And of course I have to filter per customer. So maybe I say something like customer equals one. So now I have 7 hours for customer, because for the other customers, I don't have any task yet. So it will be zero. Cool. So now we can get this query and put it in the workflow. So here in my generate invoice workflow, I add another action that I call run SQL query. I put the query here, and then for the customer, I already have a token, so I can use the customer ID token, because customer, remember, it's an input parameter. And of course, for it to be safe for SQL injection, it's not safe the way I did it here. More safer would be maybe to bind it as a SQL parameter. So I will create, let's call it customer ID. I will put this here. And here I will use the built-in SQL parameters. Okay, so I'm passing the customer ID, and now I need to store a result. I don't have multiple columns, so I can do it the simple way, total hours. Right. Okay, so now I think these two actions are inverted. So let me rewire them. So I need this to go here, and I need this to go here. Okay. Cool. So then in the generate PDF action, I can also write the total number of hours now. Right. And then if I also need it, like the total amount, again, there's multiple ways to do it. I could do it from the SQL action, so select two amounts. I could also use some tokens. So let me check in the tokens. I believe we do have a do math token. Math. yeah, do math token. So I can give it an expression. It will give me that result, like an expression like this. So let's hope this works. I will test it out. So going back here, total amount should be like this. Total hours. This editor adds lines. I will have to check the source code after that to make sure it doesn't add lines in these expressions. And we multiply that by the property customer, and let's check hourly rate, the name. I forgot the name, so hourly rate. So before that, let me check the source code to make sure that I didn't get any new lines in here, because those would break this kind of tokens. So you see it added some new lines in here. I don't like that. So that was with the new lines. So maybe what I will do instead of cleaning it up, I will do a notepad kind of cleanup, and then I will replace this token. Total amount, do math, and I will do it until the end. Okay. So now let me save and test, and let's see how the invoice looks like. Pass customer ID 1, open this URL. So apparently it worked. Out of the box. I'm very glad that sometimes it does. So now the only thing left to do is maybe add the button. So we are nearly out of time, but I'm sure I can do that real quick. Add the button, call it generate invoice. And then in the action, call the generate invoice action, and this will call the workflow that I created. We pass the ID, so this is the customer of the current ID from the row that I click. We get back the invoice URL in a new variable, and then I just do maybe a redirect for now. Redirect to URL, give it this URL. And maybe I can do a forced download, but sometimes browsers don't respect that always. So that's it. I'm saving. So now let's see the new button in action. Generate invoice. So now you can see it's linked to the UI. So yeah, I mean, in 15 minutes, we are able to add a new cool features to this product. Of course, with a nice template, this would be look so much better. But maybe we'll get to that in a future webinar. So I hope you enjoyed everything that happened today. We can linger on a few more minutes if there are any outstanding questions. But I see there are none. So let me thank you very much for being here, for being part of this webinar. I hope to see you again next week. If you have topics or questions that you want discussed in this webinar, you can also send it to us in advance so we prepare them. So thank you for being here. It will help us a lot if you can fill the feedback form, and have a wonderful week. I'll be seeing you next week.